And in the words of that song we've just listened to, we have a summary of the motivation, the ambition, and the passion of Erna Golding. We're grateful that you have come to share in this memorial service today. Let's open in prayer. Let's all pray. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for us, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. As we come to you, our blessed God, we ask that in these moments, as we reflect on a life well lived to your glory, that we might know the gracious help of the Holy Spirit, that you would comfort our hearts, that you would, Lord, teach us the lessons of her life, that you, Lord, would place within us a great gratitude that ever such a life should be gifted to a people and to a congregation such as we are. And we ask this in Jesus' strong name. Amen.
Thank you. I'm here on behalf of both my husband David and myself. For many years, we sat with Erna in that fourth pew from the front. I'm sure she's there in spirit. We first met Erna Goulding at a Bible study in Dr. Ives' home during the first year of our marriage. That was about 42 years ago. We'd been married a tenth. We were only the second couple Dr. Boyce married as he began his ministry here. In the Bible study, we'd requested prayer. We needed a new apartment, and we had a very limited student budget. Erna handed us a slip of paper with a name and phone number on it, and we ended up becoming her downstairs neighbors at 1813 Pine Street, the building owned by Dr. Koop. In that apartment, Erna took a picture of us in our wedding attire on our first anniversary. We go back far together. When the Ives moved away, the Bible study moved to our apartment, and that's where our friendship deepened. We were neighbors, we shared a Bible study together, many prayer requests. Many evenings we'd hear Erna as she came home from work at Children's Hospital on Bainbridge Street. And I'd often be cooking dinner and I'd say, come on in, come join us. We have plenty. We usually sat with her on Sundays right over there. And she became sort of a spiritual mother to us. We shared interests in history, music, the arts. We enjoyed exploring Philadelphia together and taking long walks, which she called hikes. Since she seldom found parking on Pine Street when she returned from shopping, Erna would double park and ring our doorbell, crying, help, help. And we would run down and help her unload her car so she could park on Bainbridge Street and walk home unburdened. For many months, we enjoyed Erna's company, knowing only that she was, quote unquote, a nurse. It's all she ever told us. Until one evening, we went to meet her at Children's Hospital to go somewhere together. We came in and asked the receptionist where we could find Erna Goulding. And she said, oh, you mean Miss Goulding, and directed us to her office, which bore the sign Director of Nursing. We never knew she was more than a regular nurse. Not from her lips, anyway. That was so like Erna. She was always matter-of-fact, direct, and she never put on airs. We were really impressed that night by her humility despite the authority she held, and she was always like that. Erna could be quiet and intense, much like my husband. They also shared a very dry sense of humor. I often felt they were kindred spirits. She was extremely generous, but she had to be caught in the act of doing good. She regularly visited a patient at Inglis House and did her laundry regularly, too. I only found this out by catching her one evening carrying flowers and freshly ironed clothing as she went down the hall. During our tight times, and there were many of those, meat would appear in our refrigerator from Erna. We kept keys to each other's apartments so we could feed her cat. And on more than one occasion, we received a check from the Deacon's Fund at 10th, which I'm sure also came from her. In 1980, Erna loaned us $4,000 to help David begin his photography business. She did this not because she felt it was a good investment, quite the contrary. We found out later that she had expressed concern and doubt about our venture to mutual friends. In fact, we never asked her for a loan. We never sought it in any way. She simply volunteered it from her loving heart, and fortunately, we were able to pay it back promptly. Erna was always a giver. I'm sure you all know this, and only God knows how many others she's helped. We were honored that Erna often took us along to Trenton to visit her family and do errands. We had no car in those days. We didn't need one. We lived in the city. And especially, we enjoyed those outings with her. We even shared a camping vacation along the C&O Canal. She was extremely patient as we visited many of the old locks, and David documented each one carefully with his camera. Finally, one cold and drizzly day, she turned to him and said, "Today, David, we're going to a mall." And we did. She could be quite emphatic. When our children came along, Erna cared deeply about them too. She was a wonderful resource for medical advice, as you can imagine. She also reassured weary parents that intelligent children are never boring. She enjoyed them with us. She took us with our one-year-old Joanna to her first lunch in a fancy restaurant where she received a balloon, her first balloon also. And Erna took pictures. Now, Joanna was born on the day after Erna's birthday, and when she came to see me, she said, "Couldn't you have waited a little longer?" I couldn't. When Joanna was born in 1976, we were living in Germantown, not far from Erna's condo at Gypsy Lane. We had moved there a few days apart. A few days after we came home from the hospital, Erna pulled up on the sidewalk in front of our house on Schoolhouse Lane. She came in. She picked up Joanna with her little head in her hand and her body going up her arm, looked at her, looked around and said, "Yes, plenty of visual stimulation. Yes, she's fine." She plopped her back down in the cradle and then went on her way. And that was Erna. Erna was always a vivid, lively, and deeply generous friend. We were grateful to be in her prayers and in her life. It was always good to know that she was in the world with us. Yes, she always did things decently and in order, but there was always that twinkle and often a wry smile and a quiet chuckle. We will miss her very much, and we look forward to the good times with our Saint Erna in heaven.
On behalf of the family, I'd like to welcome you here to honor my aunt. Excuse me. She was a very special person. And my aunt comes from a very large family. She never married, never had children. My mom made up for that. I'm the oldest of 12. So she became part of our family in terms of when mom wasn't tied up with all those kids, my aunt would take over. My sisters wanted me to remind everybody about the fabulous trips they used to take to Dr. Koop's place up in New Hampshire, where they went camping. Now, many of you would find it hard to believe that my Aunt Erna was a camper, or a hiker, or knew everything about nature you can imagine. According to my sisters, on the way home after these trips, my aunt would have a test for each one of the girls. And they had to have the answers. And she explained all about the various trees and plants and things like that. They'd go for hikes. One time they were up there and the house was struck by lightning, which knocked her to the ground. But she got right back up and proceeded and took care of the kids and used all of her skills for camping, and they went on from there. But again, there was a test at the end of the trip. I remember my aunt mostly as a young fella, probably back in the very late 40s, early 50s, coming to Philadelphia, which I've learned to love because of those experiences. I remember Christmas time, and the fascination of John Wanamaker's with the train sets. And if you ever saw some of those old movies about Christmas, it was kind of like that. And then we'd always end up in a place called Horn and Hard Arts. My sisters will tell you that you had to have one separate food from each of the food groups. My favorite food group, of course, was pumpkin pie. But she led a fascinating life. A professional that I admired. Yesterday, one of my granddaughters, also a nurse, was married. And she's also in Philadelphia at the University of Pennsylvania Hospital as an OR nurse. And I'm proud of that. As other things about Anna that I remember, she always respected the military. She always gave to the military and to the veterans. I retired from the Army, and I respected that also. Thank you.
Earlier this week, I was able to spend time with our former Surgeon General, Dr. C. Everett Koop. And knowing that today would be Erna's memorial service, I was very, very anxious to get his response and his reaction to her life. He himself is very ill, and his words are exceedingly few. But I did ask him this question, hoping that I would get a clear response. Dr. Koop, if you could be here today and could speak on behalf of Erna, how would you describe her, both as a woman and as a Christian? He gave a one-word response, stalwart. That was all. And that word rang through my mind again and again as I made the long drive back to this area. And I realized, perhaps at a much deeper level, that that one word described your loved one perfectly. Stalwart in Christian faith, stalwart in her loyalty to family and friends, and stalwart in her commitment to a biblical worldview and a biblical way of living. And that one word, I think, is fleshed out well in this tribute written by Alan Koop, the eldest of the Koop sons. Erna was my babysitter. That's how it started. She was a nurse at Children's Hospital where my father worked. And through that connection, she became the babysitter for the Koop children. Whenever our parents were out for the evening or away for days or even weeks. I think she always thought of herself as my babysitter until I went away to college. And later, when I returned to Philadelphia for graduate school. Even now, in my 60s, I always refer to or introduce Erna as my babysitter. My sister Betsy thought of her not only as her babysitter, but also as her second mother. Erna became a member of the Koop family. She was always around, spending most weekends at our home in Penn Valley and driving with us to and from our summer vacations in New Hampshire. She had a bedroom in our house right next to mine. Erna took the Koop kids everywhere, to the orchestra, the zoo, football games, canoeing, out for dinner, to the movies. When I came back to grad school, I lived in the same building as Erna. My older daughter lived with her for one of her years in medical school. She also shared a birth date with Erna yesterday, December the 14th. Telling the story of the Koop family means telling the story of Erna. But I won't go on with any more stories, if only because very few of you here today know our family. There is one point I do want to make, and that is the way Erna shaped the Koop family in the most profound way by telling about Jesus. This story is a wonderful story about the power and responsibility of telling about Jesus. It all began in 1948 when Erna suggested to my father that he try attending 10th Presbyterian Church, where the preaching of Donald Gray Barnhouse would present the gospel in an intellectual way that she thought would appeal to my skeptical father. Over the course of that year, the skeptic became a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. As my father shared the sermons with my mother at home with small children, she became a believer, and the family started attending 10th for Sunday school and church. Because of that, my father's parents in Brooklyn started attending Dr. Barnhouse's Bible class in New York City, and they became believers. Then my paternal grandmother led my maternal grandmother to the Lord, and she spent the last year of her life writing letters to all her friends, telling them about her newfound faith in Christ. Then my father's several Brooklyn cousins followed prompting to attend the first Billy Graham New York Crusade, leading to more people in the extended family becoming Christians, a process that has extended to three generations of our family. 30 years later, one of those cousins became a close Christian friend to my oldest daughter in New Hampshire. Closer to home, my father would play a major role in the ministry of 10th Church, the Evangelical Foundation, and other opportunities opened him in surgery and government, briefly attested to by the plaque on this church wall, always enabled by the wise spiritual counsel of my mother. The Koop children, raised in the 10th Sunday School, sitting under the preaching of Barnhouse and Jim Boyce, carried on as Erna approved. My brother Norman, serving as student assistant at 10th while he was in seminary, and then going on to pastorates in New Jersey and Vermont. My brother David spoke to his college friends about Jesus before God called him home at the age of 20. Jim Boyce's first sermon as minister at 10th was my brother David's memorial service. My sister Betsy and her husband Gordon have dedicated their lives to serving the Lord in several mission organizations and now in a large church in Birmingham, Alabama. I've been blessed by a teaching career at Dartmouth College, being able to be involved with Christian student groups and by the challenges and opportunities of serving as minister of two small New Hampshire churches. I'm sure you see the point of this brief narrative of the Christian work of the Koop family. It's not our doing, of course, all by the grace of God, and to him alone goes the glory. But it all started with Erna. All we have been in Christ is because of Erna talking to my parents. When Patricia called me to tell me that Erna had gone to be with the Lord, I was dismayed because I had long planned to see her later that week. So I marked the moment by writing an email to a student of mine who graduated from Dartmouth last June and has assumed a teaching position at a prep school in New York. She had become a believer in Christ through conversations in my office and books that I had given her to read, and is now determined to use her teaching career for the Lord. I wrote to her about Erna, because although she never heard about Erna, I thought she should know about Erna, because she is her spiritual great-grandmother. Erna is the Christian matriarch of the Koop family, and through them has children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren beyond number. That's what happens when someone tells someone else about Jesus. I don't know who told Erna about Jesus, or who told that person, but I know the chain of telling about Jesus goes back from Erna all the way to those few who heard Jesus himself tell them to tell the whole world. Erna told as she was told to do. Thank God for that. And let's take a moment to thank him. O Lord our God, we thank you for the gift of Erna Goulding, and we thank you for fulfilling in her the promise that God sets the solitary in families, both in the family of her origin and in the Koop family, whose tribute we have now presented. O God, please take care of your servant Erna. If it please you, tell her how much she is still loved, how greatly she is missed, and how much we look forward to meeting again in the kingdom of God. O Lord, eternal rest grant unto her, and let light perpetual shine upon her. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Love me, God, bless us. I'm Judy Shelley, and Erna was my mentor, friend, and encourager. I first met Erna through Nurses Christian Fellowship, which I served for 40 years. And she was an amazing woman. I'd like to read just a few verses of Isaiah 54 that I think encapsulate Erna. Sing, O barren one who did not bear. Burst into song and shout, for you have not been in labor. You have not been in labor. For the children of the desolate woman will be more than the children of her that is married, says the Lord. Enlarge the site of your tent, and let the curtains of your habitations be stretched out. Do not hold back. Lengthen the cords and strengthen your stakes. For you will spread out to the right and to the left, and your descendants will possess the nations and will settle the desolate towns. And then slipping down to verse 5, for your maker is your husband. The Lord of hosts is his name. The Holy One of Israel is your redeemer. The God of the whole earth he is called. Erna had a big tent, and she had stakes dug in all over the world. Probably there are people from China, from the Philippines, from Japan, from the United Kingdom, from Nigeria, and around the world who are listening to this memorial service. Erna served on the board of InterVarsity Christian Fellowship, as well as the board of Nurses Christian Fellowship International, the Nurses Christian Fellowship National Council, and is chair as the Mid-Atlantic Leadership Council, affectionately known as MOC. She took her responsibilities seriously. She always showed up and participated fully. In 1992, when she was hospitalized for severe congestive heart failure, we went to visit her and found her sitting on the edge of her bed, talking to her travel agent, making reservations for a flight to Fiji for the Nurses Christian Fellowship International Conference. Nothing stopped Erna. She was a quiet but powerful presence in each of those settings. She could walk into a situation that was total chaos and bring order and unity within minutes. Most of her work was behind the scenes, but when she sensed God was giving a vision, she made it happen. When I first co-authored a book on spiritual care, Erna was quite pleased with it, and she said, okay, now we need one on spiritual needs of children. And I said, I'm not qualified to write that. And she said, what would it take to get qualified? And I said, well, I'd need people who are actually providing spiritual care to children from around the country to get them together in one room and talk about how they're doing this. She said, okay, I can provide the place. And she looked at my boss, who was the director of Nurses Christian Fellowship, Grace Wallace, and gave her this very deep look. And Grace said, I'll find the money. And she did. And Spiritual Needs of Children came off the press about a year later. Then Erna said, you know, we really need a professional nursing journal. And she knew that was part of my vision. She said, we need one for Christian nurses so that we could publish articles about spiritual care. And I said, yeah, I've tried to get this started, but we don't have the money and we don't have the personnel. And she said, we'll find them. So she went around and she dug up people from I don't know where that were going to publish it in their basement for free. And we finally were able to work through some of that. And now that is a professional journal that is published by Lippincott. And the content is solely directed by Nurses Christian Fellowship. So it is a truly Christian nursing journal. And if it hadn't been for Ernest's persistence, it wouldn't have happened. She insisted that Nurses Christian Fellowship become a professional membership organization so that we had a voice among professional organizations. That happened, and she saw to it that it did. She started Reason, retirees encouraging and supportive of NCF. And we're represented with two pews worth of people that in this group. She loved getting together with her friends. And some of the professional organization stuff was also being able to be with her friends. She loved the perfect high tea. And we spent many times looking around for just the perfect high tea in Ontario and the perfect high tea in California. Erna went with us. I was invited to speak at a Nurses Christian Fellowship camp in California, and I had an 11-month-old baby. And Erna said, well, I'll go with you and take care of Janelle so you and Jim can be free to enjoy it. And she did, and we traveled Northern California together for a week afterward, which was a real hoot. Erna carefully nurtured her friendships. About 40-some years ago, she got together three young couples, and David and Marcia who had just shared, and Joanne and Bill Goff, and my husband Jim and me, and said, I need young friends so that when my old friends die off, you'll still be around. So she started a Bible study, and we met in her apartment in Schoolhouse Lane for that, or in Gypsy Lane. We lived on Schoolhouse Lane. And we're all here today to celebrate her resurrection. She used to come out to the country to visit Jim and me and be laden down with a bounty from her garden, from the city, and put us to shame, and collect grass mulch to take home for her garden. And we worried because that stuff would sit in her car for a week and be generating methane gas, and she was driving around with it. We didn't know if it was going to explode or just kill her. But she insisted that she wanted to take the grass back. We finally got to the point where we said, we will bring you the grass. And she finally let us see her garden soon before she gave it up. It was always, no, you can just put it in my car. I don't want you to see my garden. It was a bit of a mess, but that's probably why. But it grew abundantly. She was a constant encourager. She gave generously to NCF and to many other ministries. She never hesitated to tell us what we were doing right. And she gently prodded us when she thought we could do better. And I think she would have told us to sing that first hymn over again and to do it louder and in four-part harmony so she could tape it. And she probably has her tape recorder going up in heaven and is taping this service. Her support gave me and probably all of her kids, and all of us are probably her kids, the courage to do what God called us to do and to do it with confidence. And I know she's looking down from heaven and enjoying this gathering of her kids, and she's interceding for every one of us now.
Good morning, my name is John Freeman. It was about 25 years ago, actually around this time, that I first met Erna. It was the beginning of the height of the AIDS epidemic, and the ministry at which I serve, Harvest USA, at that time a designated ministry of 10th Church, was making plans to begin a gospel-based mercy and deed outreach to those affected by AIDS and their families. Erna had heard about this through the grapevine, and because of her extensive medical training her diaconal experience, and her mercy-driven heart said, I want to be part of that, and became interested in serving with us at Harvest USA. And the rest, so to say, is history. In the last 25 years, she served in various capacities on our board, as a planner, as a prayer coordinator, offering the skills that she had honed over the years to help improve and grow our organization. In fact, she was responsible for the first personnel manual we had, based on one that she had written for Children's Hospital. So you know it was very thorough and very thick. It's one we still use today to tweet now and then. I know others have shared here this morning Erna's commitment to excellence in everything that she did, and everything her fingers touched and her heart embraced, and we were no exception. And you know, in keeping with her servant's heart, when she retired about 25 years ago, she began spending time with various ministries that consumed her time and her heart. And I remember at one time she actually had a business card printed that had all the names and logos of the ministries in which she served. So there was Harvest USA, Hope, Nurses Christian Fellowship, IV, CHOP, 10th Presbyterian, all crowded in this little card. I wish I had one now, but I remember seeing it. And I've never forgotten that that really summed up her life, given for the gospel. Also, through the years, I and several of our staff got to travel with her. And we had the privilege of both inside and outside the country. And traveling with Erna, forgive the pun, was always quite a trip. You know, I'll never forget in some of those trips to Ireland and Great Britain, we would be driving along and a small alarm clock would ring from her purse at 10 a.m. and 4 p.m. And as Judy said, she loved tea, and she would say it's tensies or foursies or whatever they call it, and she would order us to the nearest tea shop. But if it was much after four, she would say, okay, let's just find a pub, and actually introduced me to lime and lager. And that was very interesting. Then we'd get our car and we'd go on our way. Through the years, she did various things in our ministry. Although she worked several times during the week, her normal time to serve was Thursday morning from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. for about 25 years on Thursday morning, in which she would come in and this multi-talented lady would clean sometimes. She would stuff envelopes. She would send donor receipts. She would answer the phone when volunteers one-third of her age were petrified to do so and still don't do so. And she would water the plants. She was expert at that. I know one of our staff, David White, told me the other day, he has about 25 plants in his office, and he said the first time he met Erna, he walked in and she was watering and he introduced himself, and she said, well, that's very fine, but I'm working now. And that was Erna. However, it was this last year, beginning with her 90th birthday, a year ago yesterday, of course, that her health started to deteriorate and decline over the next year. And it was in that year that she had to give up more and more due to her increasing frailty, something that none of us were accustomed to see, so it was a big learning curve for us. But what an honor to be around her, especially during this last year, to see more of this dear woman's heart, her gentleness, her kindness, as she allowed me, us, members of our staff, just to love on her in so many ways, whether it was delivering her to her doctor's appointments that usually were about every other week to and from Simpson House, or taking her shopping as Erna did, or as Nicholas did, for a computer just less than a year ago, because this 90-year-old had to be online and had to be tweeting. Or spending the day, Irene would often spend the day with her trying to figure out what was wrong with her computer over there. But especially in this last month, just prior to her homecoming, just allowing us to sit with her, pray with her, read scripture with her, hold her hand, sing to her, we saw a softness emerge as never before. And I'm sure many of you experienced that. We shall all miss Erna Isabel Goulding. There was no one else like her. God really did kind of break the mold with Erna. And we are all so much more the blessed for that and for her. Sleep well, dear lady, until we meet again to serve him together forever.
Let's pray together, shall we? Let's all pray. Our gracious Lord, as we have been listening to the accounts of Erna's life, we come to you who are her Lord and her Savior, you who have taken her into your immediate presence, you whom she now sees and knows with eyes not now of faith but of sight, and into whose presence she has come with great joy. We come to you. We come to you to thank you that before the foundation of the world you set your love upon her. We thank you that in your mercy you laid out the circumstances of her life that she would come to know you for herself. You gave her the gift of faith that she could embrace you as her Lord in Jesus Christ, your Son. We thank you that you kept her from all the temptations of childhood and youth, that you kept her through her educational years, and that you gave to her gifts and graces that she cultivated by your help to become the person you intended her to be. We thank you, Lord, that all of her life has been all of you from beginning to end. We thank you that every good and gracious thing that we have recognized and that we have acknowledged today through the mouth of many witnesses is due to your great favor, and we praise you for it. We thank you that one way or another we have had contact with this woman, that the impact of her life has multiplied in the lives of other people. We cannot tell, Lord, from our own lives what kind of impact we will have in future generations, but we've seen a snapshot in the record that we have heard today of the way in which you have used a woman of God, a mother in Israel, and you have used her for the glory of your Son and for the praise of your name. We want to thank you for that. We want to thank you, Lord, for all that she meant to so many people. We also want to thank you, Lord, for her present experience, for everything that she hoped in has now been fulfilled. Every longing that she had has now been realized. Every ambition that drove her has now been completed as she is in the presence of her Lord. We thank you that that means for her that when she closed her eyes for the last time, she opened them in glory. That when she said goodbye to her earthly friends, she said hello to the Savior. That when she left here, she immediately entered into the company of just men and women made perfect. We think of those that we know who are in your presence and who will already have welcomed her and old friendships been renewed and a new friendship formed in the sense that one whom she knew by name, one whom she loved with all her heart, the Savior who died for her and rose again, she has met him and sees him and knows him personally in a way that she only did by faith just a few days before today. Lord, we thank you for this, and we pray that we might comfort our hearts and that we might ask ourselves the question, would we, if we were to die today, open our eyes in the presence of the Lord Jesus to be reunited with her and with others that we know who have died believing in the Savior? Lord, will you please minister to our hearts? We ask in Jesus' strong name. Amen.
For our scripture readings, I would like to thank Reverend Carol Wynn, who in his pastoral care of Erna had access to her Bible after her death and drew from her underlined and commented parts of scripture the following readings. First of all, from Psalm 49, a reference to those without God and without hope. Do not be overawed when a man grows rich, when the splendor of his house increases, for he will take nothing with him when he dies, His splendor will not descend with him, though while he lived, he counted himself blessed, and men praise you when you prosper. But then Psalm 150, where those who do know God learn to praise him. Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his mighty deeds. Praise him for his excellent greatness. Praise him with trumpet sound. Praise him with lute and harp. Praise him with tambourine and dance. Praise him with strings and pipe. Praise him with sounding cymbals. Praise him with loud clashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And then finally, Erna's favorite psalm, as well as her mom's. Psalm 139. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You hem me in behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high, I cannot attain it. Where shall I go from your spirit? Or where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light about me be night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is bright as the day, for darkness is as light with you. For you formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God! How vast is the sum of them! If I would count them, they are more than the sand. I awake, and I am still with you. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me, and know my thoughts, and see if there be any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
A text without a context becomes a pretext without a proof text. If you open up Erna's Bible, you come to the title page. Over the title is that quote. A text without a context becomes a pretext without a proof text. And what that simply means is we're not to just kind of throw out scripture verses to make them saying whatever it is we want them to say, including even in a memorial service. We're to teach what the Bible actually teaches. So with that warning from Erna in mind, let me review what Psalm 139 teaches. And because she noted in her Bible that this was her mother's favorite and hers too, well, all the more reason I had better do it justice. Now, you have the psalm in your text, and I'll be going along with it, so please have that with you. The psalm, first of all, appears to be kind of a me psalm. I mean, if you'll notice, there's hardly a line that does not have I or me in it. And David seems to be enthralled by all the attention that he is receiving from God. Indeed, you might even think that through the psalm that God is enthralled by David. So we begin with verse 1. It says, O Lord, you have searched me and known me. God can't seem to get enough of David. He's like the fan who hungrily devours every bit of news that can be found about a celebrity. God is almost like it's presented here like a paparazzi. David can't get away from him. And it's always been that way. Even before David was born, God was intently involved in his very conception. But as we dig deeper, we see here that David is not reflecting on how important he must be to merit such attention, but he's filled with wonder. He's filled with wonder at the kind of God who is able to be so involved in his life. Look with me again at verses 2-6. Let me read those. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You hem me in, behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain it. You, that is God, is really the focal point of this psalm. You know, you discern, you know it, that is every word altogether. And here's the point that David is making. It's this kind of knowledge, reflecting about God, it's too wonderful. It's too high. He cannot attain it. David cannot grasp the greatness of such a God who knows everything. And everything includes not only what David has done, but even what David will do, even what David will say. Now, the next stanza in the psalm are verses 7 through 12, dwells on another aspect of God. Verse 7 introduces it. Where shall I go from your spirit? Or where shall I flee from your presence? Now, I made earlier kind of the crude comparison of God to the paparazzi, but there is a critical difference here. The paparazzi must chase their target. God does no chasing. It's wherever David goes or he can think of going, God's already there. He's everywhere. So he says in verse 8, if I ascend to heaven, you're there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you're there. So whether David goes the further distance up that he can think of or the further distance down, God's already there, waiting for him. So God knows everything happening to David. God is present everywhere David goes. And David is thinking, how does he do that? What kind of being is God that he can know everything and being everywhere? But that's not where David leaves things. Because it's not merely a psalm in which David is just kind of reflecting on kind of a theological thing about how great God is, you know, trying to kind of figure out what God must be like. What's really driving David is what God does. And that's what the next stanza presents for us. The next stanza, verses 13 to 16, present God as David's creator. But I want you to note particularly verse 16. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written every one of them. The days that were formed for me, when as yet there were none of them. Now go back to verse 5. There he says, you hem me in, behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. And then go down to verse 10. Even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. So you see what David is marveling over? It's that God has all along, he's been in control of David's life. God had written out David's life, and then he proceeded to guide that life to the final day. Now, if you're familiar with the life of David, you might scratch your head about this because, you know, David's life was a life filled with trouble. And some of it to his own making. Indeed, we didn't actually have it in here in the bulletin, but it's there. There's a stanza in there which David then talks about his enemies. But that's the very real context of this psalm. David is surrounded by enemies who have plagued him. And it is of great comfort to David to know that in the midst of troubles, that in the midst of being surrounded by enemies, it's God's hand that leads him. It's God's hand that holds him. And no one will cut his life shorter than God ordained, and no one will deny him what God has planned for him. Such was the comfort of our sister Erna. She did not live hoping that God might be paying attention to her. She did not pray desperate prayers hoping that God might hear. Nor did she merely hope that God might have the power or the wisdom to help her. She knew that God was always present, always attentive, always willing and able to do what was needed. For it was God that had led her along the most important path of all, and that's the path to him. Jesus explained this. We see it in John 6:37. He says that all that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never cast out. Or further down in that same chapter, in verse 44, he says, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day. And so it is by that same confidence expressed in Psalm 139. Because of who God is, and because she rested in Christ, that Erna could rest in her salvation. She knew that she was not an afterthought to God. She knew that her life was not composed of what ifs. She was in the hand of her God all along, who knew her intimately. And she did not need to worry what God might find out about her, nor did she worry about what might happen. What if she stumbled and failed to finish in faith? What if her enemy Satan got the upper hand? No, she knew that her days were ordained, every one of them, and that her God would see her through what he had planned, and that he would do what verse 24, what David makes a request of, which is to lead me in the way everlasting. That's the blessed news of the gospel. God is not watching us from a distance. He's present. This is what Christmas expresses. For Jesus' other name is Emmanuel, which literally means God is with us. And so Erna knew that when she slept, and the time would come to sleep the sleep of death, that the final words of verse 18 would come true, even more that she knew in this life, I awake and I am still with you.
Thank you.
behalf of the church and of the family, there will be a reception following in our reception hall that you can get there through those doors. And now receive the blessing of the Lord. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, and now and forever. Amen.